Hello friends, welcome to Salespedia, Current Affairs Digital Library. So today we are going to see four topics, three on prelims, just most favored nation status, Silk Route and foreign trade on January 2019. So this is on prelims perspective and India-Saudi Arabia bilateral relations in mains perspective. Now let's see the most favored nation status. Okay, so on February 15, 2019, so India has cancelled the most favored nation status, which was accorded to Pakistan. Okay, so this came in the backdrop of the Pulwama attack in which the CRPF jawans were killed. Okay, so this is the news. Now, let's see what is this most favored nation status. Okay, so this most favored nation status was started in the year 1996 under WTO's General Agreement on Tariffs and Trade. Okay, so according to this principle, the GATT has stressed all the countries to get into this most favored nation status in order to have a free international trade. Okay, so here each and every state must give this MFN status to other nations. So that is the real motive of this MFN status. Now, so what is here? So both India as well as Pakistan are signatory for this most favored nation status. Okay, so in this most favored nation status, the recipient of this status must enjoy the same equal authority as well as same equal opportunity like the country which is granting that status. So hence, if India gives a status to Pakistan, it has all the accessibility and opportunity like that of India. Okay, now, so India has extended this MFN status to all the SAARC countries including Pakistan. Okay, as a way back, all the SAARC countries has also extended those special status to India except Pakistan. Okay, so under this GATT agreement, India can withdraw this most favored nation at any time if it wishes. Okay, so initially India has actually reviewed this whether to withdraw this most favored nation during Uri attack. So now they have actually withdrew this status. Okay, so what are all the benefits of this most favored nation? First, you'll have an equal treatment among all the countries. So when you give the most favored nation status, it is considered to be the same country which is trading with us. So hence we'll have an equal treatment among the countries, and that will help to have a stable, predictable and reliable as well as competitive international trade. So which is a very rare scenario in this present year. Okay, now they'll have the lower tariffs. So lower tariffs will make the goods cheaper and it also makes people affordable. So this also a benefit of this. Then free trade. So any countries can divert, actually any country can create trades and also decreases the trade diversion. So that helps to have a free flow of goods as well as services. Then apart from that, we have equal opportunities, transparency without discrimination and fair competition. So these are the other benefits of this most favored nation status. Now, so withdrawing this most favored nation to Pakistan, so what are all the impacts it is going to have? So we are exporting the chemicals and other raw materials which are very much important for the Pakistan industries. So with this withdrawal of most favored nation status, the industries in Pakistan are going to be affected more. Okay, so this is about most favored nation status. Now let's move on to our next topic, Silk Route. Okay, so the Silk Route, we have to see about the China's influence in Silk Route, the initial founding of Silk Route and the present scenario. First, Silk Route was formed by the Han dynasties of China. Okay, Han dynasties of China. So it was started from 130 BC. It ended till 1453 AD. Okay, here the trade was used from Asia to other European countries. Okay, only silk is not transported. There are many goods like chemicals. The gunpowder which was introduced by China is traded. The paper which was introduced by China is transmitted to these silk routes. But still, silk is of more demand in those areas, particularly in Rome and Greece. So hence this route is known as Silk Route. Okay, now to the modern world, President Xi Jinping in the year 2013 has stressed an economic as well as a foreign policy of Silk Route in order to revive the ancient Silk Route of China in order to connect the Pacific as well as Indian Ocean countries. So this Silk Route actually covers more than 60 countries in this route. Okay, now what role they have set? Okay, so here the Silk Road Initiative is called as an economic belt initiative. It is collectively known as One Belt and One Road concept. That means OBOD. Okay, here it has two components. One is One Belt, another one is One Road. So One Belt means it is of the roadways, and One Road it is about the maritime. Hence, Silk Road covers both land as well as the sea route. Okay, here they have to connect the Pacific Ocean as well as the Indian Ocean. So these are the benefits of this Silk Road. Now, what are all the objective of this circuit? First and foremost, so China has to prove that it is having a bigger role in global affairs when it comes to Indian Ocean region as well as in Asiatic region. So hence, it is an ambitious project and it is considered to be the largest developmental project, economic project conducted by any other countries. Okay, so here, OBOR is considered to be an economically motivated according to China. But apart from economic motivation, it also has so many strategic motives in Indian Ocean region as well as Pacific region. Nearly all our neighbors are actually applauding this initiative and are all their members. But India is still not a member and it has not, it has denied its membership to this Silk Route initiative. Now, it also helps to address the domestic needs of the Chinese people, okay, where the routes covers most of the underdeveloped areas. So with this route, the underdeveloped areas can also be developed. And China is known for its hard power by developing nuclear technologies and other military technologies. But with this, they are trying to prove that China is also formulating the soft power mechanisms. So hence, it is also known as China's Marshall Plan. Okay, China's Marshall Plan. And they also want to impart a Sino-centric economic and security region. So Indian Ocean must be controlled by China. So that is their objectives. And moreover, they also want to convince that rising of Chinese power is not a threat. According to Western concept, USA has said that the rising of China is actually a threat to Asiatic region. But they need to make it as a negative point. So they are proving that we are not of threatening. Okay, next. They also will have the People's Liberation Army's movement. They can deploy anywhere in the Indian Ocean as well as beyond Indian Oceans. Okay, so here, first they were focusing on Asia and Europe. Okay, that is the main objectives and it covers more than 60 countries. Okay, here, we also have another concern called CPEC, which was signed with Pakistan. So that actually surpasses the Indian area. Okay, so that will have a strategic access for China in the Arabian Sea. Okay, so these are the objectives of this Silk Route. Okay, now, what are all the initiatives taken by India to counter this Silk Route measure? The first one is Project Mausam. So, Project Mausam is an initiative of Indian government which wanted to revive the ancient trade route of India. So, it is actually a countermeasure for the Silk Route. Okay, the next one. Sagarmala project is nothing but port-led development model. So, port-led development model helps to develop a port and also helps to make our defense more applicable to the present scenario. And Chabahar port, it is a deal between Iran and India surpassing Pakistan. So that will have a strategic influence in Arabian Sea surpassing this Gwadar port. So Gwadar port is in Pakistan, which has an influence of China. But Chabahar port will have influence of India. And many other naval ports in Indian Ocean regions like Maldives, Seychelles. So that will also have a strongest presence of India in the Indian Ocean regions. And also alliances with other member countries like Japan, South Korea, which are like-minded countries, which are facing the same threat of China. So these are the initiatives taken by India to counter the Silk Route initiative of China. Okay. So with this, I conclude this Silk Route topic. Now we'll move on to our next topic, foreign trade on January 2019. So this was released by Reserve Bank of India on a periodic basis. Okay, now we are going to see the export and import scenario as well as the trade balance of India in the foreign trade. Okay, so it's completely about factual information. So first, we'll see an overall export of this Indian trade. So here, we can see the US dollar has increased from 439.98 billion, which is an increase of 9.07% compared to the previous year. So export has grown a bit larger as well as the import has also seen a growth of 10.74%. Okay, so overall mercantile as well as the service sector has shown a positive growth in export as well as a positive growth in import sectors. Okay, now these are the pictorial representation of this export and import areas. Now we'll move this mercantile. So when mercantile, we can see an export growth of 3.74%, whereas in service sector, we can see an increase of just 0.01% compared to the previous year. So mercantile, we have lesser amount. Okay, then these are the pictographic information where some of the export sectors which has shown the positive growth, which means engineering goods, gems, jewelry, organic inorganic chemicals, drugs, pharmaceuticals and RMG of all textiles. So these have shown some positive development in export sector. Now other goods which shows negative growth in import sectors are petroleum products, transports, pearls, precious stones, vegetable oil, and metalliferous ore and other minerals that has shown a negative trend in import sector. Okay, so this is about the mercantile as well as some of the export and import goods. Now we'll move to the service. So service has also seen a positive growth of 7.5% in export sector and 12.53% growth in import sector. Okay, so hence now the overall trade balances, we are facing a trade deficit overall, like from $75.73 billion to $90.58 billion. So hence the trade deficit has increased compared to the previous year. So this is about the foreign trade on January 2019 released by RBI. So it is completely about the factual information. Okay, so now we'll complete this prelims topic and we'll move to our main topic, India and Saudi Arabia. So why it is in news? So Saudi Arabian Crown Prince Mohammed bin Salman is actually visiting India in February 1920. So he had planned for a 5 Asian nation visits, starting from Pakistan, China, India, and then Maldives and Indonesia, which was actually postponed now. Okay, so he has planned for a 5 Asian nation trip. So this tour has planned in the backdrop of two tensional incidents happened recently. So one is an ambassador called Jamal Khashoggi, which was killed in Turkey embassy of Saudi Arabia. So that was a serious issue in international arena, where he was brutally murdered, where the hands of Mohammed bin Salman is actually included. And other tension one is the Pulwama attack of India. It was actually, we claim it to be the attack of Pakistan. So these two tensional areas are there. Apart from this, the prince is actually visiting Pakistan and then to India. Okay, so this is about the present scenario. Now let's see how India and Saudi Arabia are actually integrated bilaterally. The first one, so India imports more than 80% of oil from outer country. Okay, it actually imports. From that, the major portion comes from Saudi Arabia. So because of this oil import, so we are the fourth largest trading partner for Saudi Arabia. So this is about the status of India and Saudi Arabia. While the prince coming to India, what are the things which are going to be discussed? First one, India is likely to ask for the cheaper oil prices. That is the first one, because the OPEC countries, in which Saudi Arabia is the head, is actually charging extra levy on Asian countries. It is actually Asian premium. We call it as Asian premium. So for that Asian premium, we are paying $2 to $3 extra for each barrel of imports. Okay, so now we are going to ask for a cheaper oil prices, and we are also want to showcase that OPEC is having a preferential terms for US and other European countries. So hence India is planning to form a buyers forum including China, Japan as well as South Korea. So this buyers forum is also on the cards of India, and now they wanted to have a stable energy price mechanism. So these are the problems which are going to be discussed during this India Saudi Arabia meeting. Okay, now what role they have asked? Now we need an energy cooperation which must be very strong with Saudi Arabia, because US has sanctioned against Iran as well as Venezuela. Okay, so Iran and Venezuela. So we have to have a strong relationship with Saudi Arabia, because we have only 6 month waiver to trade with Iran and Venezuela. Okay, now Saudi Arabia is also so much interested in investing our India's National Investment Infrastructure Fund, which funds for most of the infrastructure projects like engineering, then buildings, as well as port-led development. So India is also stressing Saudi Arabia to invest in India's National Investment and Infrastructure Fund. Okay, and they are also focusing on technology, agriculture and energies, also securities, that is defense, including counter-terrorism. Okay, so these are some of the areas which they are going to discuss in this scenario. Now, even Saudi Arabia is also going to invest in refineries, which is in Maharashtra's Ratnagiri area, along with UAE's investments. Okay, so these are some of the sectors they are going to discuss in this present meeting. Okay, now let's see what are the other things. Indian diaspora is actually the largest in the Gulf Cooperation Council. So we have a stronger reason to stress for this oil supplies. Okay, then we also have the largest Hajj quota to annually to revive the pilgrimage one. Okay, so we have a strongest relationship with Saudi Arabia. Now what are the things about Saudi Arabia? So Saudi Arabia is actually shaping this world with this energy market. So this is considered to be the world's third largest energy producing country. So hence it has the strongest power. And also it is a unique place of the Muslim world headquarters, where Mecca and Medina is present in Saudi Arabia. And also it also has an influence in all the Middle East activities, even in the wars, as well as determining its defense positions. So Saudi Arabia has the strongest position in Middle East. Okay, now what are all the things we can do? Okay, the first one is, initially the Gulf states were mostly focused on America as well as British, but now the America as well as the British are moving away from this Gulf states. So hence the Gulf states are taking the greater responsibility of managing their regional peacefulness and stability. So now what India needs to do? So India needs to move away from its bilateral approach in case of Gulf nations, because we have the largest number of the diaspora living in there, and we also have some major stake in Indian Ocean region, in where the Yemen attack has also happened in Indian Ocean region. So in order to have a regional security as well as peace, so India needs to move away from bilateral approach, and it also need to have an integrated regional approach, so that the ever rising problems of Middle East can be solved as well as in the Indian Ocean regions. So hence what we need to do is, we need to move from a bilateral approach towards an integrated regional strategy in order to secure India's positions. So these are the way forward for India's and Saudi Arabia's relationship. Okay, so with this I conclude today's topic. So thank you. So please subscribe, like and share our comment. Okay, thank you.